last session on demystifying the credit scenario, I'd first like to call on stage Mr. Santosh Kamath, Managing Director and Chief Investment Officer at Franklin Templeton Fixed Income in India. Mr. Kamath has over 20 years of investment and research experience in the Indian asset management industry. He has been recognized with the Most Astute Investor Award for Local Currency Bond Research, INR Bond Markets by the Asset Magazine for 5 consecutive years. Can I request Mr. Kamath to kindly come on stage? Next, I'd like to call upon Mr. Rashesh Shah, Chairman and CEO, Edelweiss Group, to kindly join Mr. Kamath on stage. Rashesh has been instrumental in building Edelweiss into one of India's leading diversified financial services organizations. An MBA from IIM Ahmedabad, he also holds a diploma in international trade from the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, New Delhi. Rashesh is a regular commentator on macroeconomic policies and has served as president of FICCI, which India's Apex Industry Association in 2017-18. To moderate this panel, I'd like to call on stage Mr. Prashant Nair, National News Editor at CNBC TV18. He has been covering and reporting on India's leading companies for nearly the last 16 years and is regarded as one of the most astute commentators on the financial markets, particularly the stock markets. Prashant, over to you.
Thank you very much. This is the last session. I've been told that the program has been going on from 9 in the morning. So the responsibility of making this session interactive and lively rests solely on two stalwarts, Santosh and Rashesh. Thank you very much for being here. The title of this particular session is Demystifying the Credit Scenario. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with a quote from perhaps the world's best known equity investor, Warren Buffett. I think it was in 2011 when he said that credit is like oxygen. When there is enough of it, it is not noticed. It goes unnoticed. But when it disappears, either credit or oxygen disappears, that is the only thing which is noticed. I think that broadly, in a very broad top-down way, sets the context nicely for where we are as far as the credit cycle in India is concerned. I don't think we're in a situation right now where credit is absent. We were at that point in time, probably more than a year back when the ILNFS bomb went off. But we've come a long way from there. So let's just set the context for this particular discussion. And let me ask both our guests here to tell us where exactly we are and how far we've come. Thank you very much again for being here. Santosh, let me come to you first. Where are we now? Have we passed the worst, are we past the hump in that sense? And are we getting back to normal kind of levels?
If the smartest equity commentator is asking the credit guy where we are, it means the markets are bottomed out, right? Otherwise, the credit is never in focus among, I keep watching your channel for many, many years. 99% of the airtime is equity. Lately has been very high on credit. It means that, frankly, it's kind of bottomed out. That's my broad sense. Having said that, the best way to find out how the credit is doing is look at the spreads. And by the time the information comes to normal investors, it takes a while. But for practitioners who wants to invest, so we have close to a $10 billion book, and we need to invest, say, 4,000-5,000 crores every quarter to keep kind of doing what we are doing. Till some time back, it was a luxury to keep getting money. The mini takers, we could lend at higher levels. Now, actually, then nobody's coming to asking for money. So you can imagine my plight. People think that markets are bad. It's very easy to... So it's very difficult to get good deals. The spreads are coming down. And I think that's the first step to say that credit is normalizing. But doesn't other players, they'll find it difficult to get to know today. It's like the real estate, right? The dealer or the brokers on the real estate market, they can come to know that it's selling. By the time you and me know, the price would already gone up. So similarly, I think the spreads are coming down. Clearly, I can see that happening. Maybe a quarter or two. March 20, I think, will be the bottom on the credit cycle.
Yeah, I think the idea is to see this in context. I think the last year and the last 5 years have been fairly trying for Indian economy as a whole. I think the last year has truly been, you know, highly volatile, but this panic and the liquidity crunch and all. And after all of this, almost everything globally has gone wrong in the last year. I mean, in this year, which is about to get over, fortunately. Almost globally, everything has gone wrong. I think India also, a lot of things have gone wrong. And after that, we are still averaging 4.5% to 5% GDP growth. We have to come out of this. How much more and all we have to see. And same thing in the last 5 years. I think only in hindsight, we will realize what we have gone through with more than 13 lakh, 14 lakh crores of NPAs in the banking system, changes like demonetization and GST and RERA and all of that coming in. And the economy has taken a lot of change. But hopefully, a lot of this will create a base for a stronger growth. So we are, as we look at 2020, I do think that 2020 will definitely be a better year than 2019 for sure, but could be a starting point of Indian economy coming back on track. All the ingredients are there. I think current interest rates are as low as we have seen for a long time. Though spreads are high, interest rates are low. Home loan rates are at a, you know, 10, 12 year low. And if RBI keeps on cutting, home loan rates will go below 7.5% also by March. At this home loan rates, at this, even the corporate tax cut will start really seeing the impact in the coming year. So when you add up all of this, the ingredients are that. What do we make out of the ingredient? Will it be a normal khichdi or will it be a nice, you know, gourmet dish is what we have to see coming, going forward.
Santosh said, Rashesh, that there's no demand for loans. Is that true? I mean, you at Edelweiss have been raising money, a lot of equity, some debt as well over the last many months from around the world. But I mean, Santosh just said that the problem now is from lack of credit to a point where probably those who needed it could not get it. Now, generally, there is apathy. I mean, there is very less demand for loans.
So again, it's always like a continuum. I think last year there has been so much risk aversion that everybody wanted to be only in the safest, which is like government securities or PSUs or AAA and all that. It's like same thing happens in equity markets. People move from large caps or what they call quality large caps to mid caps. The same, I think, thing is going on that people are now starting to say maybe the risk is getting rewarded because the spreads have been fairly wide. And we are seeing that things are starting to thaw. Things are starting to open up and it's a cycle. And we just have to be able to, it's always, you always get impatient that, you know, why doesn't the cycle move very fast? But I think it takes its own time. But we can see last 3-4 months, the thawing has happened. We ourselves did a retail bond issue about a few weeks ago where we were hoping to collect 200, 250 crore, which in this market in retail is very good. We ended up collecting entire 500 crores, actually slightly more than 500 crores. So it just shows that people are looking for yield. And as interest rates are coming down, as bank deposit rates are going down, for the first time, the credit deposit ratio of bank has actually, deposits are growing faster than credit for the last almost, 8 months. So the banks are flush with cash. People are starting to feel optimistic about risk on will come back. If the global scenario also improves, then all of this will have its own catalyst. And it will take time. So we are saying from now to March 2020 is a critical period. If things keep on improving, then we should see economy coming back, credit markets coming back.
I think this plays invariably the same every time. In 2008-09, so people think that the fund managers would have gone to very stressful times, especially the fixed income ones doing last year. I can tell you 2008-09 was significantly higher stress than what we're going now. During 2008-09, the best of the best AAA companies, SBI Bank CDs, were getting credit 16-17%. It was that bad because the liquidity was absolutely not there. Guess what happened? RBI came and cut rates significantly. Liquidity came back. The AAA levels came down very sharply. And then the greed comes up saying a AAA is giving me 5% and the AA, decent AA names is giving me 10%. Then you say, okay, let me take that call and try invest something in 10 and then the spread starts coming down. And it took exactly 18 months in 2008-09 from the peak of the crisis to coming back to normal. Same thing in 2013-14. India was fragile five, the entire country was put in a bad bucket. Here there are some sectors which have been put in a bad bucket. The entire country was put in a bad bucket. Again, you know, AAA companies, PFC, REITs were traded at 14-15%. And guess what? 12 to 15 months, things became normal. So I think back of their hand calculation, it says 12 to 18 months is where all the negativities gets flushed out. And September 18, we had started this problem. I think by March 20, we are almost there. The AAA levels are so low today. So all the overnight fund which we have today, when we invest, we don't even get 5%. We're getting 4.6, 4.7 before the rate cut. One more rate cut is coming, and then we'll get 4.5. 4.5, and if Edelweiss bond gives me 10, 6.5% is, I make all my bonus on that, right? So somebody will say, okay, let me do that, and then the spread starts coming down. It plays the same time, same way every time, but it's very difficult to appreciate when you are sitting at the midst of the problem that things will be normal. But if you've seen various cycles, you know it's a matter of time. Maybe I think, therefore, it's 1 to 2 quarters, we should be normal.
Santosh, but is the 2008-2009 cycle comparable to what we're going through right now? That was a financial heart attack, right? I mean, it was mostly, at least for India, it was not a real economy problem in that sense, to that degree. Prashant,
the fear was significantly higher. So we're not talking about fundamentals and economy. I'm saying the fear. So I'll give you an example of how it worked. I don't know, some Citibank guys are here. So Citibank had a NBFC City Financial. So they needed some money. And we know that being 100% part of the City Group, they should be okay. So there was Mr. Abhijit Sen at that point of time. We met, we got convinced, and then we bought City Finance paper. And somebody said, you must be crazy. The Citibank is going down worldwide and you're buying a Citibank paper in domestic markets. We said, no, we did our research and let's buy. So we bought a few 100 crores. A good friend of mine used to work in Merrill Lynch. He called me and said, boss, suna hai tumne City Bond ka paper liya hai. Can you buy 100 crores more from me? Now, a trader knows it's not a good deal when you buy something and suddenly other offer comes up saying, mera bhi le lo. It's not a good thing to do. We said, okay, we quoted slightly higher and he sold. So I asked him, ki kyun beche ho? He said, main Singapore desk based hai. So my team is slightly getting worried saying, Merrill Lynch, US company, same Cisco ecosystem, they are selling, we are buying. But theek hai. Ek din ke baad wapas, do you want to buy 100 crores more? So again, we panicked a bit. It's not a good sign. We bought. Kada kada humne 500 crore le liya. Then to my team panicked saying, was there something wrong? Merrill Lynch, US company, sitting in US, they know much more than us on Citigroup. We are missing something. Ek hafte tak call nahi aaya. I called him after 1 week and saying, boss, mere paas 100 crore call limit hai. 100 crore bechna hai kya? He says, yeah, bechna to hai, but my guy in Singapore is saying, Templeton is buying. Templeton is a US company. They know something more than us. Right? So I'm saying that neither we knew, neither they knew. So this fear was so high, and the same thing was happening now. So economy-wise, I don't know, but fear was significantly higher at that point of time as they are now.
No, my only question, absolutely, and that's a great anecdote. It tells us so much about how markets operate and when fear grips the system. But, right now, as you said, I mean, you yourself said that we don't have demand for loans, right? I mean, demand for credit has dried up. It may be a similar kind of situation back then, but the reasons are very different back then and now.
No, I think, and Vashish was chatting, saying that Edelweiss will start disbursing loans when they can clearly see that next 6 months, 1 year, I can get money from the capital market on a regular basis. Once they have that confidence, that's the only time they will start disbursing, right? So that has to come. And that will come over, I think, next 3 to 6 months, where things will become normal. Then the demand for money will go up, because then they will have confidence to go and disburse. Today, if companies are not confident of disbursing, and I think...
You're saying they're worried about the liability side right now.
So they're saying, I don't know, I have to wait and watch. I don't know how long I'll get this money. Should I wait a bit more? And I think when the largest company of the country comes on record and says that I need to become debt-free, I think that was the sign where I think the peak was, the panic was the worst, saying the largest company has to come out and say, I want to become debt-free. I think from that time, I think it's getting better and better.
Rashish.
Yeah, I think actually what has happened in the last 4-5 years, I think India has gone through a lot of this cleanup and all that. But as a part of the process, what we have said is debt is a four-letter word and risk is a four-letter word. So anybody who's taken risk and taken debt in the last 4-5 years has either been stupid or been a chore. And that has been generally the impression that is in the average, investor, public that has got created. So this has, resulted in risk aversion, extreme paranoia about debt. Like we always said that NPAs happen in every economy, in every market. And NPAs is not equal to loss, as we saw in SR Steel, which was an NPA, very, high visible NPA in the banking sector. But in that, banks will recover almost 100% of the principal that was outstanding at that time. So NPAs will happen when there are cash flow issues, when there are inability to service. But that doesn't mean that it's a loss. Also, what we have seen in India is everybody thinks an NPA means somebody has stolen money or somebody has done something wrong. NPAs are part of the business cycle. So once we get that trust and confidence, like it has happened in equity markets earlier, maybe 20 years ago, we used to feel that equity markets, when they come down, there are some operators playing the market. And if it goes up, also operators are playing the market.
That's not changed very much. Maybe a little bit, but...
No, but it's actually changed. I don't hear this anymore. Because with so many FIIs and so many mutual funds and so many HNI investors, it is truly a very heterogeneous, diversified market. So things like equity markets being operated upon has gone away because we have trust in the markets. So equity markets can fall, equity NAVs can fall, and people don't get as much panicky. But in credit and fixed income, somehow we have felt that because of maybe crony capitalism of the past or all of that, people feel that any creditor who does not pay money back has stolen money. I think that has led to all this risk aversion and all. And the shock we had in the last 1 year, in the long term, I think this is going to be good for India's credit markets. I think from credit research to credit analysis to, you know, also the loan tradability, junk bonds and all of that, I think we'll get that somewhere. We have seen that in equity markets after the Harsha Mehta crisis. So I'm fairly positive. But as you know, Santosh said, a lot of us, we are holding liquidity. We are not disbursing as much because we want to see signs of normalcy. Once normalcy comes in, we start disbursing a lot more. Then we will also start borrowing a lot more. So we need to get confidence that the cycle has started.
What do you mean by normalcy? I mean,
normalcy is spreads coming down, spreads are very high, market is erratic. I mean, I'll give you an example. Last year, after the ILFS crisis, up to January, things were tight. Then they started improving. In fact, March was our highest SME disbursement month in our history. We disbursed the highest amount of money in March because we all thought things are coming back to normalcy. April was okay, and suddenly after May, the economy, the markets took a bad turn again. So in a way, we all realized that it's not good to declare victory too early. You want to see 5-6 months of stabilization, improvement in yield all the time, liquidity being available, and you can feel it. Every month, if the environment, the optimism is improving in the credit markets, you will then say that this has come back to normal, and now we can start opening up. And, you know, our disbursements and all. And when we start doing that, the cycle will start. Because currently, every bank, every NBFC is holding back a lot more. And they are waiting for normalcy. So we, and I also hope that by March 2020, things get back to normalcy. And once it gets back to normalcy, the demand for loan, supply of credit, all of that will start coming back in some stability.
In a way, everybody's become more discerning, right? I mean, you're waiting for spreads to come down, but you're also, I guess, in terms of the asset side, you become more discerning, right? I mean, who to lend to? I mean, I guess checks have gone up. It's become more rigorous. And as provider of capital, the same goes for you as well. That is what has happened.
Yeah, so therefore I said, ultimately, the first beneficiaries are the AAA ones. Then I said, the greed comes up saying, I want to lend to the least risk company, but if somebody's lending at borrowing at 5 and somebody's borrowing at 10 and I think that 5% captures that risk, I'll say, let me put a small portion in that 10%. If I put in, some other mutual fund says, oh, Templeton is going to outperform me, they also, and this is the way it starts. So first, money definitely goes to the perceived least risky companies, then it starts slowly going up, and believe me, 1 year, 2 years down the line, it will be absolutely as normal as it was pre-18.
So where are we now for AA rated corporates and below? I mean, what is the situation?
Oh, the spreads are, I'm surprised you believe in ratings still now. So you're asking rating-related questions, but...
You don't, Santosh?
So rating is one...
Okay, that's another. We'll just come to that, but okay. First...
So why I'm saying is that because same double, there could be two double-rated companies. One, the spread would be 25 basis point, one could be 250 basis point. Right, so let's not go there. But slightly more risky than AAAs, those companies, the spreads are coming down very fast. So they may have come down by 150 basis point over the last couple of weeks. But I'm saying you guys can't feel it because you don't sit on the trading desk. But I can sense that the spreads are just collapsing. More monies are chasing them. No new supplies.
So you're saying spreads are down 150 basis points for companies slightly more risky than AA?
From AAA.
Slightly more risky than than AAA.
Slightly
okay.
More perceived high risk than AAA. May not be actual. Actual risk may be even lower in many cases. Okay. But the perception was a bit negative. Those companies, we are seeing the spreads coming down very sharply. Two reasons, lack of supply. These companies are not looking to borrow money for 2 years, 3 years. And the spread was too high. But somebody took a chance and then the spreads are coming down. next level would be when they come down, then next level, and this keeps, and that's the way it will happen.
So this is.
But I would also add that Santosh will not become more discerning after this last 1 year episode, because he was already a lot more discerning than an average bond investor. So I think he has always been discerning, and I think that will become the norm in the market. I think all of us have learned, but I think I would say the NBFC industry as a whole has actually come out fairly well. It's been 14 months of crunch time. Most people have managed their liabilities. Most people have managed normal business. Growth is not there. I personally think FY20, NBFC asset base will be down by 4 to 5% as a whole. So it will be a degrowth here. But in spite of a degrowth here, I think people have learned to manage liabilities. So NBFCs were good at managing asset side. I think the last 1 year, they have shown that most of them can manage the liability side also. And investors will become more discerning. I think credit research, as I said, will be one area where people will invest a lot more. Credit rating will be one opinion, but over and above that, people will overlay with a lot more independent credit research. And I think the era of credit research is starting in India.
So, I mean, exactly on that point, which you raised, right? I mean, you asked me whether you still believe in credit rating, sort of rating agencies and their ratings and opinion. So what has been your learning over the last 1 year since the ILFS? So
just before I think the big change of the last 12 months, so we meet many promoters to get a feeling of what they're doing, the company. The big difference, according to me, over the last 1 year, a year back, that CEO or the promoter was only looking at the asset side, including many NBFCs, right? Liability was CFO's job and treasurer's job, saying, no, you can get me money. Now, that's different. Now, when I speak to promoters and CEOs, they're equally now concerned on the liability side. That's a big change that has happened. I think Vashesh was the only few NBFC promoter CEO who was equally looking at liability and asset. Whenever I used to meet him, he'll talk about liability and he'll talk about asset. Most of the other NBFC CEOs were too concentrated on asset
side. They wanted to grow the asset side, but not very...
No, they were taking it for given that liabilities, so CFO will get me from somewhere. So I remember meeting a large housing finance company was looking to borrow very short term as compared to what the loan they give. And I asked that promoter group, saying that, why do you need 3 year money, right? You are giving a 15 year loan. He said, we'll refinance it after 3 years. I said, what happens if you don't get money after 3 years? No, we'll pay 50 basis point higher. And I said that there may be a time that you pay 100 basis point, you pay 500 basis point higher, you may not get the money. He said, nahin, 50 basis point, mein toh there's a queue outside my office. Now that's changed. Now they're equally concerned about liability. So some of the learning is that if you can't be not looking at one side of the business. You have to look at both sides of the business. Coming back to ratings, obviously it's a view by one set of agencies. So when we look at credit, we look at almost everything. We speak to the sell side analyst, equity analyst, private equity investor, banker, promoter, CEO, CFO, and ratings. You take a total view. Many times the equity market is a good indicator of what's going to happen to debt. Sometimes the credit is a good indicator, rating is a good indicator. Sometimes the private equity guys will tell you what's happening. But I can tell you one thing. There are many, many companies in India. I get shocked sometimes when your channel and other channels, I keep listening and put a target price of X and Y and stop loss. And I know the company is on the verge of default tomorrow. Right? The company has come to us saying, if you don't give us money, we are going to default tomorrow. And the share price, you're talking about stop losses and technical analysis and moving averages. So many times, I think the equity market doesn't give so much importance on the fixed income and the credit side. Invariably, the spread widening is a first indicator of something is, investors are getting slightly more careful on the company. And Prashant, believe me, a company where spreads are high can never enjoy a high P. Look, there can be very, very exceptional cases. You can't have a cost of equity which is low. It has to have a cost of debt which is also low. So one way to look at cost of equity is you look at your CAPM models of risk-free plus beta into blah, blah, blah. Don't do all that. Look at cost of debt. Cost of equity is very, very highly correlated with cost of debt. If you want a higher P, if you want high P and therefore you want to make money, look at the credit spreads. The credit spreads will tell you what the lenders are talking about this company. Rating is one factor, but the credit spread is the key factor to look at.
And you reckon companies, corporations have learned that lesson? I mean, not just look at on the equity side of things, but try and lower your cost of debt as well, cost of funds as well. Focus on that.
I don't think they get it fully. In this kind of markets, they're careful. Come 1 year, 2 years down the line, things will be normal. I think they keep forgetting that. In 25 years, I've never seen equity channels talking about debt more because they never learn.
Santosh, have credit rating agencies, in your opinion, become more agile, faster in terms of issuing opinion? Some believe that they've maybe become too aggressive in terms of downgrading and things like that. I mean, do you find that?
Human psychology, right? You, when things go a bit bad, you obviously get extremely conservative. When things are good, you become positive. And that's true with every company. It's a human, I think. So I think that will happen. Almost all agencies, including auditors, including rating agencies, including fund managers and credit, everyone will think twice before taking a step. And then slowly things will become normal, then will become optimal. And again, believe me, again, you'll become greedy over a period of time. So this cycle always happens. So now we are in that slightly more conservative. Everyone is slightly more conservative. But things are changing slowly.
Let's just come to the economy now, because I think that is the big backdrop sort of in front of which we are all sort of talking about all these different permutations and combinations. Rashesh, what is your opinion? We've got the RBI meeting, which is coming up. What is your expectation? Will the RBI respond in a very big way? Will they announce a change in stance? What will that mean, if anything at all, for transmission into rates? Because that has been another big point. You alluded to that briefly in your initial comments, but a little more detailed sort of thought on that.
I think we all agreeable that, you know, India real interest rates are still much higher than where they should be, because inflation is still low, though it's started inching up, but I think it's still in a zone where it's very comfortable. So given where interest rates are, where inflation is, interest rates in India are fairly high. So I think all of us believe another at least 50 to 75 basis point lowering of interest rate will help the economy get back on track, whether they do it in increments or they front load it. But I do expect that RBI should cut at least another 25 basis point, because that's a good risk reward of getting the economy back. I think the green shoots are starting to appear. So overall, I do think the economy has gone through a very bad phase, but it's stabilizing. I don't think we're out of the woods yet, but it's not getting worse. Until August and September, things were getting worse on a month-on-month basis. They've at least stabilized and started inching up now.
And Santosh, do you think it's stabilized, or you think we're still in a bit of a downward drift?
So I think typically it takes three things for the economy to kind of come back. One is liquidity. Other is interest rates being low, or monetary policy. And third is the fiscal side. If all these three move in tandem, it's much easier and faster for the economy to go come back. 2008-09, exactly the same thing happened. Rates were cut, significant liquidity was put, and the fiscal deficit went up. Governments are spending money, and obviously we came up very fast. Unfortunately, the too much of fiscal loosening had an impact later, inflation going up and so on and so forth. This time the same thing is playing out. First, the interest rate got cut, the liquidity liquidity is abandoned now. Unfortunately, the third piece, I think we may not have too much luxury on the fiscal side to open it up very fast. So I think it will take slightly more longer, according to me, as compared to what happened in 2008-09, because the third piece of fiscal is missing. I think the numbers there will look a bit stretched. So that part is missing a bit. Otherwise, rates being down, liquidity being high is the two ingredients. My feeling is it will take a bit longer than what happened in 2008-09.
I mean, some believe it is entirely, money supply and monetary policy which has to do the heavy lifting, and it can do the heavy lifting if the response is powerful enough. Do you agree with that, Rashesh? If you assume that the government does not spend...
Actually, we need both. We need an expansionary monetary policy and expansionary fiscal policy. Always expansionary monetary with expansionary fiscal has a risk of inflation in the future, but it's a risk currently worth taking where global oil prices are and all, because we need to get growth back. And India is an economy, we can handle a 4 to 5% inflation as long as we can get to, 7.5% growth. Because a 5% inflation and a 7% growth also gives you a nominal GDP growth rate of 12%. Our current nominal GDP has come down to about 6.5, which is very, very low, because we have to keep both in mind, real and the nominal. So I do think that it's a risk, worth taking. And I do feel the government is also convinced about it. They are pushing. They are doing two things. They are wanting to spend, not hold back on spending. And they want to control the fiscal, and the way they are doing it via asset sales. Huge disinvestment program is underway. Both they are selling companies, but they are selling assets also. It may not happen immediately before March, but I do think in the coming year for FY21, we will see government spending also pick up and asset sales also pick up. And fortunately, there is a lot of global capital looking for yielding assets. So I know currently Bharat Petroleum and Concor is up for sale. A lot of global firms are interested because the global rates are also at an all-time low. So I think given all of this, I do think the next year we should have an expansionary monetary, expansionary fiscal policy. And hopefully oil price and global economy stays put. We should have inflation also under control, which will be a golden triangle for India.
Currently, the spread between 2 to 10-year G-Sec is at a 10-year high, right? We are getting interest rate cuts, but somehow the market is not getting too comfortable buying the longer end because the feeling is that the fiscal deficit is going to give off and therefore the more supply of bonds. So I've never seen, it was way back in 2008-09, where you had a more than 100 basis point spread between 2-year G-Sec and 10-year G-Sec, and that too in a cycle where we are seeing more rate cuts. So that gives me a bit of concern thing that if fiscal deficit indeed starts going up, the long end will start going up, which is not the best thing to do. So therefore, I think it will take slightly more longer than a normal phase.
But I mean, for this transmission, for the longer end to come down, I mean, can the RBI do something? I mean, there are suggestions afoot.
The RBI can do a few open market operations and all that, but if the supply is large at the longer end, the steepness will continue. So short end will keep coming down. Long will not go up, but will not come down. So I think the steepness may continue for some, till the time you get a feeling that government is very serious on the fiscal side, and you know they will do asset sales, or else they will not spend. Once that market that gets that confident, then I think it will be okay. But now the market doesn't have confidence on that long end of the curve.
How will Santosh, the bond markets respond broadly if the government were to decide to spend a little bit more, breach the fiscal deficit target, not wait for the assets money from asset sales to come in, which will only be the bulk of it probably next year, next calendar year, right? Will that kind of, as you said, there are three legs. And that is the third leg, right? Will it be very uncharitable? Will it?
So, Prashant, there's a saying in the market that when in doubt, be conservative. So, if you don't know what the government is trying to do, you be conservative and assume that government is going to do a lot more fiscal expansionary, and therefore the yields are high. Once the market gets convinced, this is the way the government thinks and this is what the government will do, I think market will start pricing in that way. Today, you don't know the tax numbers collections are much lower. Whether disinvestment will happen, such a big disinvestment will happen by March 20, you're not very clear. So a lot of confusion on the longer end, on the fiscal side. I think till that confusion doesn't get cleared, I don't think the market will get confidence.
But the government may also look at the longer end and say, well, the market is telling us don't do it. I mean, there is another way to look at it, right?
No, I think generally the market is looking at the shorter end, generally. Like deposit rates are coming down, MCLRs are coming down, repo is coming down, liquid fund returns are coming down. Longer end, I don't think many people watching saying what's happening to my 10-year yield or so people say let me borrow for 1 year, 2 years. But if the long end continues to be high, what it means is that sooner or later this short-term rates will also start going up over a period of time. So ultimately, if the lower the interest rate has to come down in the economy, the longer end also has to come down. And for that, the confidence on the FISC has to come back strongly, saying that FISC is not going to expand too much.
Rashesh, what is your view though on the FISC itself? Do you think? I mean, it seems very, very unlikely that the government will meet its said fiscal deficit target, right, after the kind of numbers we've had.
I think for this year, a 40-50 basis point slip, like 3.7, 3.8, 3.9, is more or less the market will factor in. It's a worthwhile price to pay for growth coming back. So I do hope that government continues spending, doesn't hold back, because I do believe that asset sales will not happen so fast. But the year after that, the next year, I do think they will control the FISC by raising money via asset sales on one side and using it to continue spending on the other side. And if the corporate growth and all starts coming back, then things should start to normalize. But that is why we have to watch between now to March. I keep my fingers crossed that the government doesn't hold back on spending, because obviously government income has come down, tax revenues have come down. But if they continue to spend, I think it will be good for the economy as of now. So we do look at that. I do think the Indian corporates will also, next 4-5 years should be a good run for that, because corporates will become more efficient. I think on two things. One is the tax rates have come down. But the other side, this entire what has happened last 2 years, and we spoke about companies saying they want to be debt-free companies and all, because what has happened is the debt market is imposing a huge amount of discipline and cost efficiency on people. So I think corporates will become a lot more efficient, capital efficient, because we've been efficient on the operating side as India opened up, but our capital efficiency is still not there, because a lot of And I hold largely credit market transmission was the reason for that, because our equity markets are fairly efficient. But in credit markets, still people are giving credit based on name, credit based on collateral value, which is always uncertain. But not a lot of people are looking at cash flow or have the capability to look at cash flow and do, you know, we have been able to do that on the retail loans, but on a lot of wholesale corporate loans and otherwise, there is a huge dependency on name and a huge dependency on collateral value. As that goes away and we start looking at cash flow, I think a lot of efficiency will come, because then companies will have to generate cash flows for meeting that borrowing rather than just allow asset values to appreciate.
You know, one more very, very point may look very different. In the short term, a efficient NCLT is a bit negative for investments.
Right? Sorry, the short term?
A efficient NCLT framework is a bit negative for investment. Imagine you are a steel company. Normal time you could have done a brownfield and expanded your capacity by 20%. Now you know that I can get that particular steel company, everything is okay there at a much cheaper cost, or I can get it and I don't have to spend so much time doing it. You will not expand brownfield, but you will say, let me buy that company. Earlier, the idle capacity used to be there. That used to run with a low capacity utilization, and the existing company used to keep on, you know, kind of expanding. Now your power plant will say, okay, I'll buy a power plant, which has gone into NCLT. I'll buy a steel plant, I'll buy roads, I'll buy renewable projects, I can buy a mall, I can buy. So if there's so much on sale, why would you want to put a new investment on the block? And unless the new investment comes up, jobs don't get created, it takes a bit while. So I think this NCLT has to clear as fast as possible. So it's like if a sale is happening, then you'll say, let me buy in the sale rather than do something else. So I think many times, for example, this SR and others, the faster they get resolved, I think it's good for the economy to put new investment on the block.
Overall, Santosh, you seem a bit more circumspect about prospects for, revival. The underlying economy reviving.
I think it will be slower than what many other market participants are believing to be. That's what my broad sense is.
So, have we bottomed out, according to you? I mean, in your opinion?
We are close to bottom, maybe.
Rashesh, you believe we have indeed bottomed out, and probably repair is...
I would think so. I mean, it's always, you know, after so many years in the economy and markets, one thing you learn is you don't want to stick your neck out and make any forecast. But I think the worst is over. The worst is behind us. The last 1 year has been really trying for the economy. Having gone through that for the economy, I think the worst is behind us. In fact, maybe the idea is to look out for pleasant surprise on the upside, because when the economy comes back, and India has come back also, because there is still a lot of underlying, you know, latent demand and all, there are always problems. But I think it might surprise us on the upside maybe a year down the line if we continue on this expansionary fiscal, expansionary monetary policy, global economy stabilizing after a very turbulent year. I think we might get surprise on the upside. And the idea is to be cautious, be conservative, but keep an eye on that optimistic hypothesis.
Santosh, all the recent developments, I mean, we have the most recent is the Carvey sort of development. NSDL transferring shares, which were pledged, de-pledging them, transferring it back to clients. I mean, that putting a big question mark for lenders who had lent against those securities. We have the sort of PMC thing. We have the DHFL issue before that. Do all these add to the complexity are we clear on these issues in terms of who takes primacy, for example, in the Carvey issue?
So Carvey, frankly, I don't know too much about it. I keep saying, please invest in debt, that's much safer. Put in my fund, that's much safer. And frankly, I don't know too much about the equity, the way it happens. But it's cooperative bank, you know, one or two you keep hearing occasionally. Typically, the market in a negative environment takes a view that everything is going down under, right? So I stay in a society where obviously we also have some money which is invested in a cooperative bank. The day this happened, there's a meeting called and everyone said, let's redeem everything. Let's pay a penalty and move to SBI. And I said, come on, it's not that bad, right? And say, my God, who made you Templeton CIO? Things are so bad, tomorrow everything is going to fail. And I was trying to say, no, and they told me that their objective is to minimize losses, right? I said, no, your job is not to minimize losses, you do the optimum returns. So I was speaking my fund manager language, and so the panic was very high. But I think if one takes that view that all cooperative banks are going to suffer and, you know, large banks can have issues, then obviously we are going to go back many, many quarters of at least a year or so. I don't think that's happening. So this occasionally, a few things will happen here and there that will result in more supervision, more strengthening. Next time you will have some other problem. We'll have. I don't think it's a contagious suddenly that everyone gets fearful. I don't think that's happening.
Rashish?
See, also, I think I also had said it in the morning. We should remember that we are coming out of almost a five-year credit cycle with huge NPAs and cleanup and all of that. And it's been a very painful phase for India. I mean, a 13 lakh, 14 lakh crore NPA is very painful. It was almost 10% of the GDP at that point of time. If we have come through that, we should be heaving a sigh of relief. But what happens is when you do a 42-kilometer race, at the 41st kilometer, you are not saying 41 is behind me and only 1 kilometer is left. At that last kilometer, a small incline, a small, you know, turning out there, it really pains you the most. And you are so hassled with everything that goes wrong. And I think maybe that is where we are getting, because all these are obviously things have to be cleaned up, and I completely agree. But in the context of the amounts involved, I think we have to keep that perspective in mind. Because remember, while we are saying all this, almost 40,000 crores of SR steel is going to come back to banks, which is fully provided for. There are another 8 or 10 accounts, which will give another 40, 50,000 crores. So you might get almost 1 lakh crore coming back to the banking system, which has been fully provided for. So it's almost like equity money for them. So there has to be something good also coming out of that.
Santosh, we have both debt and equity investors here in the audience. Just leave us with some ideas. I mean, for investors, what should they look at when assessing equity and debt investments? And what's the interplay, according to you, between both of them?
I think they need to invest just a ballpark. You need to invest in the asset class where the fear is the most. When the fear is maximum, then obviously it means that other things becoming remaining same, the asset gets undervalued. And if everyone is talking about that, obviously that means that it's kind of maybe overvalued. So first, and I'm sure they are smart enough to get a feel of where the people are most negative on. Typically, when the people are most negative, typically that asset class is kind of undervalued. So I can get a sense when I go to meet distributors, the kind of questions they ask me, I can make out that where is that panic maximum. So that's one way to invest. And second, obviously, is to keep a balance. Don't go the either extremes, because you never know, fast-changing world. Third, again, this is not my area, but I'm a big believer of US equities. Most of us have domestic debt or domestic assets. Our expenses or liabilities can be in dollars. You want to send your kid to US and you want to go for a foreign holiday. You don't have a dollar asset. I think you should keep some dollar asset, which US equity fund looks to be a good option. I think a mix of these three looks to be a good option today.
All right. I think we'll wrap up this discussion. Rashish, Santosh, thank you very much, both of you, for being with us here on this panel discussion. Very enlightening comments. Thanks indeed. I think we will, I wanted the audience to sort of put some questions as well to both of them, if we can pass the mics around. I know that we have some very prominent investors in the audience as well. Anyone?
I think the messaging was so clear that there are no doubts.
Crystal clear. I think then we'll wrap it up here. Thank you very much, both of you.
Thank you, Prashant.
Appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Thank you.